Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Night Hunt by Adam Wright, narrated by Greg D. Barnett. Chapter 1. Winter bulldozered relentlessly over Maine, burying the state beneath a shroud of snow. Dearmont got just as much of the white stuff as everywhere else, and Main Street became a winter wonderland of snowdrifts on the sidewalk and Christmas lights festooned between buildings. For Harbinger P.I., though, the season was more like a winter wasteland. Nobody came through the door. It was as if the town's ghosts and monsters were taking Christmas off, and no one had need of a preternatural investigator anymore. I opened up the office every day, but spent most of my time leaning back in my chair with my feet on the desk, or gazing out of the window at Christmas shoppers going from store to store. Carlton made coffee and sometimes got donuts from the store next door, but he was just as bored as I was, and I sent him home early most days. When Christmas Eve arrived and we'd still had no clients, I poked my head around his office door and said, "Carlton, you should go home. Take a week off. Hell, take two. I'll let you know if anything happens here." Not that I thought anything would. I was beginning to wonder if this was the end of Harbinger P.I. When I'd worked in Chicago, there'd been a seasonal slump during the winter, but nothing like this. "Okay, boss," he said, getting up from behind his desk. "If you're sure." "I'm sure," I told him. He wrapped a blue woolen scarf around his neck before putting on his overcoat, a white beanie, and a pair of gloves. "Have a good Christmas, Alec." "You too," I said. He left the office and almost ran down the stairs to street level. He couldn't get out of here fast enough, and I couldn't blame him. We'd both been getting cabin fever, sitting in this enclosed space for almost 2 months with nothing to do. I wandered back into my office and stood by the window, watching the last-minute shoppers buying gifts for their loved ones and food for the table. I was losing my edge. I still trained in the basement every day, pushing myself even harder than usual since my days were so sedentary, but hitting bags and targets didn't compare to fighting real monsters. Not only did I feel off my game physically, I was sure I was also losing my mental acuity. With nothing to occupy it, my brain felt like it was dissolving into a puddle of mush in my skull. I turned away from the window, deciding to take the same advice I'd given Carlton and leave. I wasn't helping anyone by rotting in the office, least of all myself. If I went home now, though, I'd just be doing the same thing there that I was doing here. I needed a change from staring at four walls. Outside, snow was falling, and it was damned cold, but maybe a walk in the wintry weather was just what I needed to clear away the cobwebs in my head. If nothing else, it would be good cardio, especially if it involved trudging through deep snow. Turning out the lights, I grabbed my coat and scarf and put them on while I went downstairs to the main door. After stepping out onto the street, I locked up and shoved the keys into my jeans. I put on my black woolen gloves and shoved my hands into my jacket pockets as I walked along the sidewalk. It was cold, and the falling snow was driven into my face by the wind, along with the loose snow that had been whipped up from the sidewalk. Not the greatest day to be outside, but still preferable to going home and doing nothing. A poster in the drugstore window bore a photo of Sheriff Cantrell above the words, "Missing, have you seen our sheriff?" Since attacking me at Moosehead Lake, Merlin had vanished. So Sheriff Cantrell was officially a missing person, and had been for 2 months. His daughter Amy, who was now Dearmont's acting sheriff, had been forced to launch an investigation into his disappearance so that everything looked normal to the townsfolk, even though she knew as well as I did that her father would never be found. Merlin had probably taken his body to another realm entirely, and it was driving her crazy with worry. I didn't blame her. As long as Merlin occupied Cantrell's body, and the real sheriff was locked away in a magical prison, Amy couldn't be sure she'd ever get her father back. I decided to head down the hill to the lake. Maybe a long walk along the snowy shore would give me the cardio workout I desperately needed. As I passed the window of Blackwell Books, I glanced inside and saw Victoria Blackwell at the checkout, serving a line of customers. I'd never seen the place so busy before. There were usually one or two customers browsing the shelves, but I could see 5 times that number waiting in line, and many more browsing the shelves in the deeper recesses of the store. Victoria noticed me gazing through the window and waved me inside. I went through the door, being careful not to collide with the customers coming out with their purchases clutched in their hands.
"Alec," Victoria said as I entered the store, "it's so good to see you. How are you?"
"I'm fine," I said, raising my voice to be heard over the hubbub. She raised a section of the counter to allow me through.
"Come through here, dear. I can't hear you."
I joined her behind the cash register and said, "I'm fine. Business is a little slow at the moment, unlike in here. Does it get like this every Christmas?"
"This isn't because of the time of year," she said, ringing up a young couple's purchases on the register. "This is because of our new coffee shop upstairs."
"Coffee shop?" Now that she mentioned it, I could smell the unmistakable aroma of freshly ground coffee.
"It's Devon's little pet project," she said, referring to her sister. "She runs the coffee shop upstairs while I handle the books and trinkets down here."
I gestured to the line of people waiting to be served. It seems to be working out well. I was surprised a coffee shop could bring so many people into the store. Main Street was lined with coffee shops and cafes, and drinkers had a huge choice of establishments to visit. Why did it seem like half the town's population was in here?
"It's working wonderfully," Victoria said. "The customers come in and have a drink and perhaps some cake, and then they buy books."
"Sounds ideal," I said. At least someone's business was booming.
"Why don't you go upstairs and take a look?" she suggested. "Try a piece of Devon's carrot cake. It's out of this world."
"Sure," I said. Maybe a cup of coffee and a slice of cake were just what I needed before setting off on my lakeside walk. In fact, the more I thought about it, the more I felt as if I needed those things. "I'm going to go up there now," I said. "I'll see you later."
"All right, dear," she said, smiling. "Enjoy."
I lifted the hinged part of the counter and made my way past the line of customers to the stairs. My mouth was watering at the thought of coffee and cake, which was strange because before entering the bookshop, I hadn't felt hungry or thirsty at all. At the foot of the stairs sat a blackboard with the words "Coffee This Way" written on it. Beneath the words was a simple chalk drawing of a cup of coffee. Beneath that, an arrow pointed up the stairs. Even the simple drawing of the cup with 3 wavy chalk lines representing steam made my mouth water. As I climbed the stairs, I felt a sudden stab of hot pain in my shoulder, as if I'd been hit with a burning poker. I was familiar enough with the sensation to know that one of my magical warning tattoos had been activated. That meant I was either being attacked by magic or being affected by some sort of enchantment or charm. Even though every part of my being told me to rush up the stairs and get some of that delicious-smelling coffee, I resisted. Every instinct wanted me to go upstairs, but I waited. Halfway up the staircase, gritting my teeth and gripping the railing so tightly that my hand cramped up. The magic within the intricate network of tattoos that covered my body would work to counteract whatever spell I was under. I just had to give it time. Customers, on their way both up and down the stairs, passed me by, shooting me frustrated looks. I was in the way of their quest to purchase either coffee, books, or both, and they didn't like it. The burning sensation in my shoulder receded as the magic did its work, and the compulsion to drink coffee vanished. I ascended the stairs to the second floor, where dozens of people sat on leather couches that had been arranged around a number of small wooden tables. It was standing room only, so many of the customers leaned against the walls or stood in small groups while they drank their cups of joe. A counter had been set up along one wall, and behind it, Devon Blackwell was making coffee and serving cakes from a display cabinet made of glass. When she saw me, she waved.
"Alec, hello! Can I get you some coffee and a slice of cake, perhaps?"
"No, thanks," I said. The aroma of freshly ground beans was stronger in here than it had been downstairs, and it did smell good, but now that the compulsion was gone, I could resist easily. Besides, I had a point to make. I approached the counter and pointed at the pot of coffee on the burner. "What the hell is in that, Devon?"
coffee, of course, she said, looking at me with an innocent expression.
And what else? It isn't just coffee that's making all these people gather in here like moths around a flame. She looked over at the pot and then back to me.
Well, there may be a little enchantment cast over the beans before they're brewed.
What kind of enchantment? Some sort of compulsion spell? She looked shocked at the accusation.
What? No, not at all. I don't need to compel people to drink my coffee. It's just an enhancement spell. It enhances the natural flavors and makes the coffee taste and smell irresistible.
Do you think that's right? I asked her.
Is what right? Giving people a tasty drink?
Using magic to draw them in here. And what's with all the people downstairs buying your entire stock of books? More magic?
No, she said. Well, not intentionally, anyway. It seems that the enhancement spell is still in their systems after they drink the coffee and go back downstairs. So while they're walking through the store past the shelves...
The books seem just as enticing as the coffee, I finished for her.
Devin nodded. But I assure you that the book thing is entirely incidental. I didn't mean for that to happen at all.
But while it's happening, Victoria is happily taking all of the money from the book sales.
It isn't like they're being forced to buy things they don't want. The enhancement simply makes them more attracted to the books they'd like to read anyway.
Devin, you're using magic to influence people. She sighed.
It may have gotten a little out of hand.
Looking over at the coffee pot, she said,
I'll dispel the enchantment.
She walked over to the pot and passed her hands around it slowly, reciting something unintelligible under her breath.
There, she said, returning to the counter. Now it's done.
And it still smells delicious, I said truthfully. I'm sure you'll get plenty of customers without resorting to magic. She nodded, and then her eyes widened as if she'd suddenly remembered something.
Oh, did Victoria tell you about your gift?
My gift?
Yes, we made you something special for Yule.
Coming out from behind the counter, she said,
Come with me. I can't wait to show it to you.
She headed for the stairs, and I followed. Hey, are you still serving coffee? Someone shouted after her.
I'll be back in a moment, she said as she led me downstairs.
Taking me to the back of the shop, she opened a door that had a sign designating it for staff use only. It was some sort of storeroom, and inside, along with boxes of books sitting on the shelves, was a pile of gifts wrapped in shiny silver paper and adorned with red bows.
Yours is here somewhere, Devin said,
picking up various packages and inspecting them before putting them down again.
Ah, here we are. Happy Yule, Alec.
She handed me a package that was bulky and felt squishy.
Thanks, I said. Aren't you going to open it? She said, looking at me expectantly. I'm sure you're dying to know what's inside.
Yeah, sure. The only gift the Blackwell sisters had given me in the past had been an oversized sweater. I had a feeling the package in my hand contained something similar. It wasn't that I was ungrateful, but the last sweater was so large as to be almost unwearable, and now lay on the floor in my closet. I had a feeling this new gift would soon be joining it. I removed the bow and the silver paper to reveal that the gift was, indeed, another sweater. This one had been knitted from black yarn and looked big enough to clothe 3 people.
Thanks, I said. It's great. You can never wrap up too much in this weather, Devin said, beaming. Why don't you try it on?
Maybe later, I said.
Oh, okay.
When I saw the disappointed look in her eyes, I said, You know what? I'll try it on right now. Her face brightened.
Excellent. Here, let me help you with your jacket.
Before I even had the zipper open, she was tugging the jacket off.
With it folded over her arm, she stepped back and indicated the sweater in my hands. "Go on, Alec, try it."
I slipped the voluminous garment over my head and pushed my arms through the sleeves. It dropped over my body, almost reaching my knees. Looking at Devon, I nodded. "I'm sure this will keep me warm." She raised a finger.
"Just wait a moment, Alec."
After a couple of seconds, I felt the sweater begin to move. It shrank slowly, tightening around my body until it fit perfectly. Devon beamed.
"Yes, it works! Victoria and I have been working on perfecting that spell for ages."
I looked down at the form-fitting sweater and nodded in appreciation. It really was a nice piece of clothing now that it had fitted itself to my physique.
"And the rune that we knitted into the sweater will bring you luck," Devon said, pointing at a tiny knitted white rune on the left shoulder.
It was shaped like a tiny triangle with a different symbol at each point, a horseshoe, a shamrock, and a star. She brought my jacket to me and held it open while I slid my arms into the sleeves.
"You'll be much warmer now," she said. "You must have been freezing with nothing but a flannel shirt and t-shirt under your jacket. Now, I must get back to my customers upstairs."
She opened the door and ushered me out. When we were back in the main part of the bustling store, she planted a warm kiss on my cheek.
"Have a great Yule, Alec."
Before I could answer, she was heading toward the stairs that led up to the cafe area. I pushed past the crowds on my way to the front of the store. Despite the enchantment being removed from the coffee, books were still being snatched off the shelves by the customers, and the line at the checkout didn't seem to be getting any smaller. I bumped into a young woman who was holding a stack of books in her arms. She dropped them, and they scattered across the floor. My eyes caught the titles. They were various texts on witchcraft. "Sorry," I said, stooping down to retrieve the books.
"Alec?" she said. "It's me, Lucy."
I looked up and realized who she was. Lucy Hawthorne. I'd met her in the fall when I was working on a job that Felicity had filed under the title The Case of the Conjuration of the Midnight Blood. "Hey, how are you doing?" I asked, as I handed her the books I'd knocked out of her hand.
"Great," she said. "In fact, I was hoping I'd bump into you while I was here in Dearmont. You still owe me an interview, remember?"
"I remember," I said. Lucy was a horror writer, and I'd promised to tell her about the life of a preternatural investigator.
"Are you busy right now?" she asked.
"Not really. I was just taking a walk to clear my head." She grinned.
"Great. I'll join you."
Sure. I liked the idea of having some company, especially after seeing hardly anyone except Carlton for the past few days. She put the books she'd been holding back onto the shelf. "Aren't you going to buy those?" Shaking her head, Lucy said,
"It's weird. I thought I really wanted them for research, but now I'm not so sure."
She gestured to the door.
"Let's go."
We pushed past the line of people. As I opened the door and Lucy stepped out, Victoria shouted to me from behind the counter.
"Alec, did Devon give you your gift?"
I nodded.
"She did, thanks. I hope it brings you lots of luck."
I waved my thanks and stepped out onto the snowy sidewalk where Lucy was waiting.
"Speaking of luck," she said, "isn't it lucky that I bumped into you today?"
"Sure, if you want to look at it that way. But since most of Dearmont is in the bookshop at the moment, the chances of us meeting were pretty high." She shrugged, the movement almost lost beneath her thick winter jacket.
"Yeah, I guess that makes sense. So where are we going?"
I looked up and down Main Street. If we walked back toward my office, we'd end up in the residential area. In the other direction lay the highway, the lake, and the woods. "How about down the hill to the lake?"
"Sounds good."
We set off down the incline that led away from the stores and toward the edge of town.
"So, how's business?"
Lucy asked after we'd been walking in silence for a couple of minutes. "Slow," I told her. "In fact, it's non-existent. That's why I'm out here in the cold instead of sitting in the office. I was going nuts staring at the same four walls every day with nothing to do." My phone rang. I fished it out of my pocket and saw Bud Clark's name on the screen.
Bud was the director of the Society of Shadows headquarters in Salem. I'd done him a favor in the past by tracking down two demons that had killed a Massachusetts P.I. Bud had returned that favor by sending a cleanup crew to Butterfly Heights after I'd encountered a siren and some cabal members there. "I have to take this," I said to Lucy. I answered the call. "Bud, how can I help you?"
"Hey, Alec." He sounded weary. "I was wondering if you could do something for me."
"Sure, what is it?"
He sighed. "My son, Ethan, is missing." "No, that's not strictly true. He isn't answering his phone. The reason I'm calling you is because he's in your neck of the woods. He was visiting some friends in Deermont. There was some mention of a party, but I'm not sure where it was being held or who else was going. He's 18, so I probably shouldn't be worried that he isn't answering his dad's calls while he's with his friends, but..."
"But you want me to check that he's okay," I said.
"Yeah, if you don't mind. I'd come up there myself, but, as I say, there's probably nothing to worry about, and the roads are a nightmare at the moment."
"No problem," I said. "I'll check on him. Do you know the names of the friends he was visiting here?"
"Yeah, he was staying with a guy named Steve Kershaw. I'm sure you'll be able to find out where he lives."
"I will. Leave it with me, Bud." I ended the call.
"Sounds like you have a job after all,"
Lucy said as I slid the phone back into my pocket.
"Yeah, sounds like it. Well, it isn't really a job. I just need to check on a friend's son."
"Can I come? I can interview you on the way."
I didn't see a reason to refuse her. She'd provide some company while I found out where Ethan Clark was, and she'd get a glimpse into my work, albeit a very brief glimpse.
"Sure, my Land Rover's back that way."
We turned around and headed back up the hill.
"Today must be your lucky day," Lucy said.
"How do you figure that?"
"Well, you were just telling me how you were going crazy because you had nothing to do, and now you have a case."
"It's hardly a case," I said. But the word she'd used, lucky, stuck in my head. Was there more to the sweater Devon had given me than just a rune knitted into the shoulder? As we passed Blackwell Books, I glanced in through the window and saw Victoria serving the line of customers. The line was shorter now that the sister's enchantment had been removed. But had another spell been activated when I'd put on the sweater?
Chapter 2. I told Lucy what Bud Clark had told me over the phone and added, "I need to find out where Ethan's friends live. We'll probably find Ethan there, and then I can call Bud and let him know. You see, it isn't really much of a case."
"Unless he and his friends have been taken hostage by a gang of trolls or something?" she suggested.
I frowned at her. "I'm sure that isn't what happened." Up ahead, I saw Amy coming out of a store with a sack full of groceries. If anyone knew where Steve Kershaw lived, it would be her. She could save me some research. When we reached her, she was loading the sack into the back of her police pickup truck. She saw me and offered me a weak smile. She looked tired. The disappearance of her father weighed heavily on her shoulders, and it had taken its toll on her.
"Hey, Alec,"
she said, her voice flat and emotionless. "Amy," I said, "how's it going?" She closed the truck door and shrugged.
"Not good, to be honest. This is going to be my first Christmas without my dad. I guess I have to get used to that."
"We'll find him," I said. "Merlin will crawl out of whatever rock he's hiding under soon, and we'll be ready for him."
"And then what?"
she asked, looking me in the eyes.
"You can't force him to give my dad's body back."
"I'll try," I said truthfully. She shook her head.
"Face it, Alec. He can stay in there for as long as he wants. Meanwhile, my dad is locked away in some sort of ice prison. I'm beginning to see now why he hated PIs.
I had no answer to that, no words that would comfort her.
"Listen," I said, "I'm trying to find out where someone lives. Steve Kershaw, do you know where I can find him?"
"Why?"
she asked, narrowing her eyes suspiciously.
"What do you want with him?"
"A friend of mine asked me to check on his son. Apparently he's staying with Steve."
"Is that all? Doesn't sound like the type of case you take on. Where are the monsters?"
"There aren't any. Like I said, I'm just doing a favor for a friend." She studied me closely for a moment, as if by doing so she'd be able to tell if I was telling the truth. Then she sighed.
Sure, why not? Steve's parents are in the phone book anyway, so you'd find his address easily enough. He lives on Whitman Road, in a big house with a huge arched window. You can't miss it.
Thanks, I said. I was about to turn away, but I stopped myself and said, Amy, what are you doing tomorrow, if you're alone and you need some company?
I'm working, she said.
She opened the truck door and climbed inside. As Lucy and I continued along the sidewalk, she said,
That wasn't a good time to ask her for a date.
I wasn't asking her for a date, I said. Her mother is dead, and her father is... Well, it's complicated. I just didn't want her to be alone, that's all.
Uh-huh. Keep telling yourself that, if it makes you feel better about striking out.
I didn't strike out because I didn't ask her for a date. Lucy nodded.
Of course you didn't.
She didn't seem convinced. I was beginning to wonder if bringing her along had been a bad idea. We got to the Land Rover and climbed in. I started the engine, dialed the heating up to max, and waited while the snow on the windshield melted into rivulets of water that cascaded down the glass.
Okay,
Lucy said, pulling down the zipper on her jacket and taking a notepad and pen from an inside pocket.
Tell me all about the life of a preternatural investigator.
I backed out of the parking space and steered the Land Rover onto the road. I'm not sure there's much to tell. I fight monsters for a living and try to help people deal with their paranormal problems. She nodded and scribbled some notes onto the pad.
And how did you get into this line of work?
When I was young, my mom was killed in a car crash and I went to live with my dad. He was heavily involved in the monster hunting business, so I followed in his footsteps. The part about my mom wasn't exactly true. I'd thought that she'd been killed in an accident, but I now knew that the crash and her defection to the Midnight Cabal had been a ruse. I wasn't about to go into all that with Lucy, though, so I stuck to the story I'd been told my entire life.
I'm so sorry, she said, looking up from the notepad. I didn't know.
It's fine, I said, turning north on Main Street. It was a long time ago. That wasn't true either. Although the accident had been a long time ago, I'd only recently realized that my mother was still alive. And then I'd watched as she'd rejoined her sisters in the coven and forgotten entirely about my dad and me.
So, what kind of training did you have to undertake before you became a PI?
Lucy asked. I had a vague idea that Whitman Road was in the more upmarket part of Dearmont, but I wasn't certain, so I turned on the GPS and typed in the street name. I was right. It was located a couple miles north of town. Hand-to-hand combat, I told Lucy. Training with different weapons, learning the lore that surrounds various creatures, ancient spells and rituals, how to recognize paranormal activity, that kind of thing.
Uh-huh.
She made more notes.
So you're equipped to deal with any monster that crosses your path?
Yeah, that's the idea. In reality, though, I'd met monsters for which the training hadn't prepared me at all. Mr. Scary was still at large. Merlin was walking around in Sheriff Cantrell's body. I dealt a blow to the Cabal by destroying one of its outposts in Faerie, but the organization was still out there, lurking in every shadow.
So, how do you get clients? Do you just wait for them to come to you, or do you seek them out?
I wait. They come to the office seeking my services when they need my help.
In your line of work, you must get a lot of weird people coming through the door.
I sometimes need to make a judgment about what they tell me. Sometimes people attribute a paranormal cause to mundane events. She wrote that down and said,
So, you have to be a good judge of people, as well as being able to fight monsters?
Yeah, that comes from meeting people in their time of need. By the time my clients come to me, they've usually exhausted every other avenue of help and are desperate.
You're their last resort?
That's the way it usually goes. We were leaving town now, heading north through the driving snow. Lucy fell silent for a moment while she...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.